Back in the 17th and 18th century, when slavery was a way of life in this great country of ours, one of the ways the owners would try to keep their slaves well behaved was to send them to church. So oftentimes, simple churches would be built near where the slaves lived, out in the fields, where the slaves were allowed perhaps to sit in the back or on the balcony of white churches. The strategy was to use the church to keep the slaves in line. Something went wrong with that strategy. Basically, God went wrong with that strategy. While all the white folks were quietly listening to the gospel with no real visible effects, God was busy blending that gospel with an African culture filled with energy and music. And something brand new was created that later became a critical piece of the story of how slaves gained their freedom. The gospel took root in a lively way in a new community. And that wasn't the first time that this kind of thing happened, the gospel seeping out beyond its borders. Back in the first century, as Peter and Paul went out to persuade fellow Jews that Jesus was the Messiah, they were, shall we say, getting mixed reviews from their target audience. Meanwhile, the Gentiles, an entirely different culture, was listening in on the edges from out the fields, if you will, out back, and warming up to the gospel the mighty way. These were different, exotic people, an Ethiopian eunuch, rich Gentile landowners. And then there was Cornelius, who was of all things a Roman soldier, a repentant Roman soldier, converted to the gospel. The book of Acts, along with this passage that we're about to hear, is largely a report of how the leaders of the church tried to come to terms with the fact that their most enthusiastic converts were people that they least expected to be moved by the gospel of Jesus. Here's Peter telling the Jerusalem council what happened with that Roman soldier, Cornelius. Let us listen to the word of God.
John baptized with water, but If then God gave them the same gift that he gave us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could hinder God? When they heard this, they were silenced, and they praised God, saying, Then God has given even to the Gentiles the repentance that leads to life. May the Spirit of wisdom guide our understanding of this scripture.
Conversation is going to be between a Christian grandmother whose grandson is playing out on, let's say, the Christian temple playground, and a Muslim man whose two kids are also out on the playground. It's a nice sunny day, just like today.
Was most interested in the followers distinguishing themselves themselves by their kindness and fairness toward one another.
That should be the heart of it for all of us, but we still manage to get tripped up.
And speaking of kindness, it looks like my humble little girl just punched her brother. It's time for us to go.
Just one more dumb question.
Yes?
Do you think these two great world religions will ever learn to, oops, never mind, I think my grandson just tried to intervene between you or two?
We'll shoot for peace in the playground first, and then we'll attack the rest of the world.
As ourselves, and to start that by understanding it. specifically to learn enough about our neighbors that we no longer fear what they look like or what they believe. It is so true that those of us who are part of religious traditions that go back to a much earlier time, we have to figure out what to do with those texts that reflect the standards of those times, the violence and the roles of men and women. Also, especially, Islam and Christianity have to acknowledge that the call to convert others to our way of thinking in both of these traditions opens the door to some of the most awful things that we see through the years and that we still continue to see. These two faith traditions also, I believe, we have to be honest with ourselves that our belief in an afterlife and our belief that there are certain things we can do while we're here on earth to secure our place in that afterlife, all of that opens up the door to behaviors in both Islam and Christianity that can do terrible, terrible damage. There are realities in our traditions that can make it hard for us to work and play well together. And these realities don't easily go away. But it is just these realities in my mind that invite us, that beg us, if you will, to distinguish ourselves by living out the essence of our tradition and by seeking that same essence in the traditions of others. When the stakes are so high, there isn't much we can do that is more important than loving our neighbors as we love ourselves, especially when that neighbor is of a different faith tradition. One way to start is to find a person whose beliefs differ from ours and ask them out to lunch at Panera Bread, to ask those stupid questions, to begin to get to know one another. Some of you all may remember the movie from a while back that told the story of Gandhi. Near the end of the movie, as Gandhi lays in bed, weakened from his hunger strike, a man comes up to his bed. Like Gandhi, he is Hindu. He is wild-eyed, very troubled. He shouts, "I'm going to hell!" "Why?" Gandhi asks. "Because I just killed a child." "Why did you kill this child?" "Because the Muslims, they killed my child, my little boy, who was just this high." Gandhi sits still for a moment, and he says, "I know a way out of hell for you. Find a child whose mother and father have been killed, one about this high. Take that child in and raise that child as your own. Only be sure that he is a Muslim. And be sure to raise him as a Muslim." These are the things that we know never happen, really, right? But the very best of our traditions does ask us to love our neighbor